Well, good morning.
Good morning.
We welcome you on this day to worship our Heavenly Father. And hello, happy Palm Sunday to you. As you know, Palm Sunday is the beginning of our entry into Holy Week. And so we recognize that as Jesus came into Jerusalem and the crowds rang out and said, Hosanna, Hosanna. What we're going to do today is a little bit different. In the tradition of kind of what's sometimes called the Palm Sunday procession, we're going to start in the beginning of the back of the church by reading our scripture verses. So if you'd like to stand and join us, and then we'll process in with the cross as we sing our opening hymn. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 12th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches and palm trees and went out to meet him, crying out, And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written. His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. The crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to bear witness. The reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they heard he had done this sign. So the Pharisees said to one another, You see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the world has gone after him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We sing together, O glory, Lord, and honor.
Thank you.
name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, pray. Success. Since we are gathered to hear God's word, to call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ into the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, and I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. We would invite the children to come up for the children's message. Well, good morning, Scott. How are you today? Good? All right. Gentlemen, come on up over here for a minute. So today is Palm Sunday. All right? And look at what we got here. We have palms over here. Now, we don't really think so much about palms in the sense being as that maybe here in church we use these, right? And we say, Hosanna. And then also, sometimes when you're cutting down trees or you have a tree in the backyard, you may plant a palm tree, okay? And what good is a palm tree, do you think? I don't know, what good is an oak tree? No, trees are good in themselves, but the reason why people chose to take these off the tree and shake them was because they wanted to praise Jesus and they wanted to say how joyful they were to see him come to town. In our day, if you go to a parade, people usually will shake what? Pom-poms, right? Or ribbons. Sometimes if they'll have a balloon or something else, you know, that helps them stand out. And then they'll say, hooray, hooray, right? In Jesus' day, they use that word Hosanna because they saw that Jesus was the Son of God and they wanted to praise him. And so that's the wonderful thing, all right? So you, at the end of service, you could take one of these home if you'd like, okay? And so, but it's a wonderful thing, right? So we get to praise Jesus and we get to say what? Hosanna. Instead of saying hooray, we say Hosanna, all right? So let's pray. Let's fold our hands and we pray. We pray, dear Jesus, thank you for being our Savior. May we worship you like those in the crowd that day. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, thank you, everybody. Thank you. At the end of service. If I give you it now, you'll play with it. We invite you to read along with our scripture lessons found in your bulletins and on our screen.
Today's Old Testament reading is the third of four servant songs in Isaiah. It points to the servant's total commitment to his mission, even in the face of suffering. On this Sunday of the Passion, as we begin our Holy Week observance, we surely see Jesus as that servant, from Isaiah chapter 50. The Lord God has given me the tongue of those who are taught, that I may know how to sustain with the word him who is weary. Morning by morning he awakens. He awakens my ear to hear as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I turned not backward. I gave my back to those who strike, and my cheeks to those who pull out the beard. I hid not my face from disgrace and spitting. But the Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced, Therefore, I have set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near, who will contend with me. Let us stand up together. Who is my adversary? Let him come near to me. Behold, the Lord God helps me. Who will declare me guilty? Behold, all of them will wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them up. This is the word of the Lord. As we follow the passion history, the days ahead will take us from the acclaim of the crowd to Jesus' rejection and crucifixion, and then to his glorious resurrection. The liturgical poem that is today's epistle does the same. It describes the humbling of the one who is in very nature God, his obedient death, and his subsequent exaltation to the Father's right hand. Philippians 2, 5 through 11. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise for our gospel.
To the Lord your God, who is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and abounding in steadfast love.
The Holy Gospel for today is the beginning of the Passion. Now among those who went up to worship the feast, this is the gospel of the Lord according to St. John, the 12th chapter. Now among those who went up to worship at the feast were some Greeks. So these came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and asked him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus, and Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd that stood there and heard it said that it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now will the rulers of this world be cast out, and I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So the crowd answered him, "We have heard from the law that Christ remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man?" So Jesus said to them, "The light is among you for a little while longer. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he is going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. When Jesus had said these things, he departed and hid himself from them. Though he had done so many signs before them, they still did not believe in him, so that the words spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Lord, whom has believed what he heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Therefore, they could not believe. For again Isaiah said, he has blinded the eyes of the and hardened their hearts, lest they see with their eyes and understand with their hearts and turn, and I would heal them. Isaiah said these things because he saw his glory and spoke of him. Nevertheless, many even of the authorities believed in him, but for fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it, so that they would not be put out of the synagogue. For they love the glory that comes from men more than the glory that comes from God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Our hymn today is No Tramp of Soldiers' Marching Feet.
Of soul.
Well, grace, peace, and mercy from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Turn this off. Today we welcome you on this Palm Sunday to come and worship our Heavenly Father together. And it's always important that we, at this time, begin to focus on Jesus, our suffering servant, but also the fact that he is king. And so it is that we see in our readings today, as well as in our scripture text, that present understanding that Jesus comes to be king, but doesn't serve like a normal king. He comes to serve as a suffering servant. Can you feel the expectation? Imagine for a minute that we were there in the crowd. Imagine we were there and we were in anticipation of seeing Jesus come. The people would explode with excitement, and the street would be heard all through Jerusalem as people swarmed and shouted. The feeling of being in a large crowd and being pushed upon by people as they gather and want to see the parade. And so they tear off palm branches. They wave them in the air. And some people, even on the ground, can't see. The crowd pushes closer and closer as people look to see the procession. Children say, "I can't see," and their parents put them on their shoulders. Babies cry as the crowd gathers in. Older people can't move so quickly, and a voice is raised, and we hear a man shout, "It is Jesus!" And the women and the children hold up palm branches. And the crowd yells out, "Hosanna! Hosanna in the highest! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." You get a glimpse of the robe, the tail of a donkey. And people are moving in, walking with the crowds and following. As the people push in on you, you hear someone say, "Who is this man, this Jesus?" Someone answers, "He might be the one who Israel has been waiting for." Another voice could be heard saying, "He is the Messiah, the Redeemer of Israel." And as the crowds push on, they see him continue in his procession. And then as the crowd begins to disperse and people are walking back as they go home, there one sees Philip and asks him, "Sir, we would like to see Jesus." That's what Philip heard that day when was asked by the Greek Jews to see if they could see Jesus. But why did they want to see Jesus? Why would we want to see Jesus? We long for him. But maybe the one question is why? Why do these people want to see Jesus? In fact, why do you want to see Jesus? I feel that that question has some weight today, especially as we come as God's people to worship him. But more than that, it has a question to the world, at least in the world that we know. There is much religious talk as well today in our culture about Jesus. Some is good, some is bad, but the question of why do you want to see Jesus? We are very aware of those evangelical questions that people sometimes to ask us. Do you love Jesus? Do you know Jesus? Is Jesus your Lord and personal Savior? Those are questions we hear in the South. But maybe the real question is why? Why do you want to see Jesus? If you've been following the last few weeks of our sermons series, you heard about Nicodemus coming to Jesus at night. You also saw the conversation that Jesus had with the lady at the well, not knowing who this man was asking for water. She learns and tells her entire community. And then there's even the blind man as well, too, who says, "I don't know, I was blind, but now I see." And Jesus gives him a full understanding of who he is. And then last week, we see that Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. And our gospel reading points us to the fact that that is the reason why the crowds have gathered. And that's the reason why people have come to see him, for the miracles that he does. But are we just expecting miracles? Why do you come to see Jesus? I mean, the wonder of who Jesus is. Just think about his first miracle there at the wedding at Cana. We watched also how he worked against the oppressing system of the taxes. We saw how he spoke to the Samaritans, the outsiders, and even the tax collectors. We see how he transgressed boundaries between friend and foe and women and men. We see how he healed the crippled man at the pool of Bethsaida. And we saw how he fed the 5,000 with loaves of fish. And how John records for us that he raised Lazarus from the dead. So why do you want to see Jesus? It's not a distant question. It's not a vague question. It really is the simple question that, like the crowds, we want to ask. You see, the people in Jesus' day didn't all see him the same. Some saw him as a great healer. Some saw him as a prophet from old. But some saw him as the fulfillment, the Messiah who had come to be among them. And so the questions of that crowd are the questions in our day. Just consider today in the culture we live in. According to statistics by Pew Research, 23% of Americans now identify themselves as not having a religion. They identify themselves as none, N-O-N-E. It should be also noted that many people have misunderstood even who God is and his love for them. And so it is no wonder then that people, when asked about who Jesus is and why they want to see him, they may answer by saying, well, he was a good man, but that's all I believe about him. You see, with statements like that and facts like that, the question for us personally is, why do you want to see Jesus? Why? You see, Jesus is not another religious figure. He's not just one among many. Instead, he challenges the crowds. He challenges us. And with that question, why? It's an important question because it means the difference between life and death. It means the difference between being a follower of him and not knowing anything about him. You see, for us, as God's children, the question why is answered in the very fact of Jesus and who he is. As Savior, he is the giver of life, eternal. In his death and resurrection, we know that God welcomes us into his family and raises us with Christ in baptism. We also recognize that Jesus is an important figure in history, dividing the difference between knowing truly who God is and not knowing who God is. The point is that when we see Jesus as our Savior, we recognize the power that he has within our life, and he shows us that he is the one who was promised long ago. C.S. Lewis, that author of the Chronicles of Narnia, was raised as an atheist, but became a believer later in life. He writes these words, "I'm trying here to prevent anyone from saying foolish things about God," he writes. "I've already accepted Jesus as a moral teacher, but I didn't accept him as his claims to be God. But it was then on that one moment when I came to realize that he wasn't just a moral teacher, but he was my Savior. You can take him as a lunatic, or you can take him as the very Son of God. For me, I take him as the Son of God." You see, Lewis summarizes for us the very fact that there is no wiggle room to who Jesus is. The reality is that he is the Son of God who came into the world to declare the works of God and to show us that by his works, he is the one who brings salvation to us. We don't patronize when we ask that question, why? But we declare an answer to it because he is our Savior and Lord. Just think about that on a personal level for a minute. I mean, in religious discussions, we can clearly say to the nuns and the atheists that Jesus is Lord, but to ourselves, that means much more than just a discourse or an argument. It means that we are able to cry out like the crowds and say, "Hosanna, the Son of Man comes to serve and to give his life for us, for me." And in turn, then what do I do with that question of why? It changes the orientation of one's life And it opens us to the very idea that we belong to God and that God has great love for us. But it also changes you. It makes you look at your sin in a different way, as forgiven but yet repulsed, because your friend dies for you. It also opens to us something greater, to see others as the children of God, and gives to us a clear understanding that we have been called to share this love with others, both in word and in deed. As Jesus enters Jerusalem, the crowds cry out, "Hosanna!" But later, another crowd will cry out, "Crucify him, crucify him, crucify him." It's why this Sunday is sometimes called the Sunday of the Passion. People have such passion, but it begins Holy Week as it draws us into Christ's rejection by his friends. Ultimately, it will open for us that Jesus then suffers. Rejected, crucified, he dies. But that's not the end of the story. Next week, we then celebrate his resurrection. So the question of why is for each of us. And the answer is because Jesus loves us and we love Jesus. Amen. We rise together in our faith and we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate, suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Today in our prayers, we want to pray for the Reinke's son who will be having surgery. We also want to pray for Mike Finn, who will be having back surgery. And we also want to pray for Vernon Yoli with health issues. Also, too, you'll recognize there in the bulletin, that we're also praying for A.P. Patchkey and for others that are struggling with illness. Let us pray. God of heaven, we come before you in thanksgiving for who you are. Lord, you come into Jerusalem and show yourself as a humble king. May our hearts be humbled, Lord, as we tell others of your love. May we find the strength to be your people, that in a world that seems to not know why you exist, may we be the voice that cares and shows your love. We pray, Lord, in your mercy. Father, we thank you for the strengthening of your people, especially for those that are struggling in areas of health. We pray especially that you'd be with those that are in need of healing. Above all, we pray for those that will have surgery. We pray for Curtis's son and ask that you be with him as he has surgery on his foot. We pray, Lord, for Mike Finn, who will have back surgery, and for Vernon Yoli as well with health issues. We pray for Doris, for Al and Drew, for Cullen, Francis, Alton, George, Billy, Carl, Doris, Jean, Priscilla, Roger, Bonnie, Linda, Gail, Ruth, Debbie, Jennifer, Glenda, Sherry, Dennis, Reggie, Dawn, Harold, and AP. Lord, we also pray for friends as well who are in need of healing. We pray for Carly, a niece of the Thorpes, who has had health issues and been involved in events that hurt her body. We pray, Lord, that you bring healing to her. We pray for Carson, a young soon-to-be wife, and pray that you give her healing with her illness. We pray for Emery, for David, for Lynn, for Willie, for Joyce, for Nathan, the Vasilia family in Iran, for June. We also pray, Lord, for the men and those that serve this nation, for the Nimsch, for Bob, Pastor Nimsch and his family, for Anthony Toops and James Butler and family. We ask that you watch over them and keep them in your care. We pray, Lord, for all of these things. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, we will take our offerings and our tithes to the Lord. Sing as we receive these offerings. We want to recognize the receiving of new members, and so we would ask Wendy and Scott to please come forward, the Barron family, excuse me, and then also the Vasilia family as well too. I do not know if there are any others. They may be at the late service as well too. You know, when you join a church, you also join a family, and one of the things that we get the call sometimes, our church is our church family. And so with that recognition, we recognize that God has blessed us with members of our church. Some of our members have served in many ways with many gifts. And so we look forward to the opportunity for you as well to use your gifts in service as you grow. And so we want to hear these words. Beloved in the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ said to the apostles, "Whoever confesses me before men, I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will deny before my Father who is in heaven. Lift up your hearts, therefore, to God of all glory, and joyfully give answer to these questions. Do you this day in the presence of God in this congregation acknowledge the gifts that God gave you in your baptism? Please answer yes.
Yes.
God enable you to use the gifts in baptism given to you to serve the church. We ask you also, is it in your intent that according to the word of God and in faith, word, and deed, to remain true to God and the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? Please answer yes, by the grace of God.
Yes, by the grace of God.
Do you also, becoming a member of this church, plan to use your gifts to the service of God and to the church by praying for her, serving her, and looking for the care of others? Please answer yes. Upon this, your confession, I acknowledging publicly that you are members of our Lutheran church and congregation, to receive the Lord's Supper, to participate with us in all the blessings of salvation that our Lord has given us to his church. In the name of the Father and the Son, amen. Let us pray. We pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing these, your sons and daughters, to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and enabling them both with heart to believe and with mouth to confess your saving name. Grant that by your word and spirit they may continue steadfast in one true faith and fellowship with this congregation, as together we await the day when all who have fought the good fight of faith shall receive the crown of righteousness through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. At the end of service, there's a gift over there for your family. So at the end of service, you can take that. Okay? So thank you. Let's welcome them on behalf of our congregation. We'll get a picture at the end of service if we can. So. We rise. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and honorable that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father and everlasting God, whose Son was undeterred but in following his purpose in life, going to the cross and dying and rising for us. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And also after supper, he also took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is new covenant in my blood, shed also for you for the remission of sins. This do also in remembrance of me. As often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We sing.
Thank you.
Go out into the world in peace. Have courage, hold to what is good. Return no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering, honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. The Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you. Amen. Our sending hymn, Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. Please be seated. On behalf of our congregation, we thank those that are watching, and we pray that you're blessed through the ministry of our church. Please, if you'd like to, join us on Thursday and also on Good Friday, and then also on Sunday morning. And the schedules are printed in our bulletin, but also on our website as well and Facebook page. Again, I want to just say, Curtis and Sandra Remke, their son, Curtis Jr., is having back surgery. So just wanted to recognize that. That's on April 5th, so we were praying for him. But I think I mentioned the foot. Sorry, not I meant the back. And then also, too, we want to get a picture with our new members as well, too, at the end of service. So, again, we welcome you. If there's anybody that we've overlooked as we transition from one secretary to another, sorry about that, and we'll try to as well work that in for you. So, thank you.